All right, cool. So, a matter of trust. So this week's passage is from second book of the Corinthians, chapter 1, verses 12 to chapter 2, verses 13. We're not going to be reading that right now. So I'll be reading that in the middle whenever that comes up. So this is just the whole passage that we'll be looking at. So let's just dive right in. So, does anybody trust me? Or why should you even trust whatever I say, you know, talking about all this, a matter of trust and also, first question, does anybody trust me? And why should you even trust me? Or why should I trust anybody? So these are the main questions that are at the heart of this passage, which runs from 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 12 to the middle of chapter 2. So why is all this trust coming up? It's all because Paul said one thing and he did another. Is it because he did it because of mistrust? So I'm telling Tarang, you know, hey Tarang, let's go out tomorrow for a movie at 3 o'clock, and he books tickets for the two of us. And then last minute I say, oh no, I'm not coming. I have some other work. And then Tarang loses trust in me. Okay, next time I tell him to book tickets, he'll be like, oh, why should I book tickets for him? Anyway, he's going to cancel last minute. Let me wait till the last minute and then I'll book. And then finally, we don't get tickets. We don't see the movie also. So this whole matter of trust comes here because in this particular passage, in this chapter 1 from verse 12 onwards, we see that the Corinth church is losing trust in Paul because Paul said one thing and he did another. The problem was that Paul said that he was coming to Corinth and he didn't go there. We'll see more of the details in a moment, but the end result of Paul's action is very serious. Even the Corinthians were whining. They were just saying, you know, but you promised and all. Just like Tarang is saying, you know, you promised you'll come at 3 o'clock. What is this now? What will I do with this ticket? Who will I go with? So it's clear that Paul's change in travel plans had seriously damaged their long-term relationship. In fact, it was at a breaking point, I would say. They were in real danger of walking away from Paul. The Corinth church was in danger of walking away from Paul. And even worse, they were even ready to walk away from the gospel. So Paul writes to them once more, pleading with them to do one thing. He says, trust me. That's all. So Paul says, just trust me. So I'm telling Tarang, you know, Tarang, hey, I'm not able to make it this time. So just trust me. Trust me on this one. I have bigger things in mind. So obviously Tarang won't understand unless I explain what the bigger thing is. So that is what Paul is doing here. He's explaining to them why he didn't come there, why they weren't able to trust him. And why is Paul emphasizing again on trust me? Why should the Corinth church trust Paul? That is where we're going into. There's a sense in which we've got that, you know, okay, now we understand. That's it. We can just stop here, end the sermon and finish up with church. Okay, trusting. Paul is asking them to trust him again. That's it, done. But if it weren't for the fact that Paul goes on to explain why they should trust him in a way that takes us right to the heart of what it means to be a Christ-like leader. Let me say that again. Long sentence. I think it would have been a bouncer to many people. Gone over the head only. So why should the Corinth people trust Paul? Because Paul is a leader figure and they don't have any other leader figure with them. So why should they trust him in a way that takes us right to the heart? It takes us right to the heart of what it means to be a Christ-like leader. In fact, it takes us right to the center of what it takes to be a Christian. So at the risk of spoiling the surprise, here's the answer to the question. Why should you trust me? Paul replies, because I am imitating Christ. Trust me because I trust Christ. So the basis of a trust between you and me is the basis for trust in the church of Jesus Christ, which is Christ-likeness. All of us, everybody is trying to be like Christ because that is the crux of the gospel. You know, Christ said, you know, be like me. That's it. So Paul is one of the best examples of a person trying to imitate Christ, trying to be like Christ. Will I say that I am trying to be like Christ? Yes, I am trying to be like Christ, but not as good as Paul is. Not as good as Tarang is, but not as good as Karan is. But yeah, I'm still trying in my own way. We're all trying. So Paul is saying, I am trying to be like Christ because I am imitating Christ. Trust me because I trust Christ. I don't trust myself. I trust Christ. I don't trust in my monthly salary. I trust Christ. I don't trust my promotion. I don't trust my boss to give me a promotion. But I trust Christ. I put my burden on him. Now, I know that we're all deeply sinned. And even though we've been forgiven and made holy and are being transformed by Christ, we never quite escape the pull from our sin. One day we reconcile with God and we are on this uphill. And then the next time we just slide back because of this one particular sin point, we slide back down. But we must never let the importance of a robust grasp on the doctrine of sin, that we must live Christ-like lives. And more than that, we cannot ignore the fact that all of us are equipped to and expected to copy and resemble the Lord Jesus Christ himself. We already have it in us. We are expected to do that. And we just need to copy that. We don't have to lead some novel new life. We just have to copy what Christ did. That's all. Do you think the Corinth church did not know this? Because this is the second book of the Corinthians. They already know this from the first book of Corinthians. Back in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16, Paul is only saying, I urge you then, be imitators of me. Again in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1, be imitators of me as I am of Christ. Stick with me and the gospel. Come with me, copy me as I copy Christ. Paul's appeal to the church in Corinth is this. But I don't know about many of you, but once I read this, I felt a little uncomfortable with this. You know, it didn't sit with me right. Because in most cultures, it is considered socially unacceptable to brag about yourself. Oh, look at me. This is how you should be. This is how you should follow Christ. So I would understand if Paul said, you know, oh, look at Christ, follow him. But he's saying, be like me, imitate me. I'm so great. I'm so great at following Christ. So be like me. This is how to follow Jesus. Look at me. I don't know if I have the courage to say that. Because first of all, I'm not transparent. So nobody knows what I'm doing. And I can't even say that with confidence. You know, look at me. You can be like Christ. But Paul is saying that. You know, look at me. This is how to follow Jesus. Is he bragging here? Is Paul trying to brag here? But yet there is a sense in which, whether we like it or not, this is the pattern of gospel-shaped ministry. We are called to live like Jesus, lead like Jesus, and to imitate Jesus. Even if our imitation is pretty pathetic, even if our imitation is just 0.1% of what Jesus did. And Paul seems to think that this responsibility weighs even more heavily on leaders. He thinks that this responsibility weighs even more heavily on leaders. So, because leaders are the one leading, and we have to imitate Jesus so that whoever sees us imitates us and in turn imitates Christ. So Paul is having the courage. Paul is having the transparency. Paul is having the trust on himself, on Christ, that he's able to say that sentence. Not once, not twice, so many times to the same church in Corinth. Why? Because this is a pretty dumb church, I guess. I don't know. But at NBCC, we are not very dumb. Just one time is enough for us, right? Yeah, we'll remember this. Don't imitate me, but please imitate Christ. Imitate Paul, imitate Christ. So yeah, let's learn more about this. It's very interesting. So now we're all having this particular fear that, oh no, how will I imitate like Christ so that people are looking at me and they will start imitating me? Because if I start smoking within my friend group, I'm pretty sure another person will smoke. Just have this. No, I'm itself smoking. What is this? What is wrong with you? You also smoke, no? Pretty sure two of them will take one smoke that day itself. That kind of an impact is what we are having as people within our friend group, within our church, within our societies. So we have to leverage this impact that we have on people and we have to imitate Christ. So is everybody feeling guilty yet? Because I am feeling very guilty because I am not at all imitating Christ. Neither in my friend group, nowhere. I feel like crawling under one rock, covering myself in one bedsheet and just be there for the rest of my life. Because living like Christ is such a huge task, if you think about it. It's such a huge burden to just imitate Christ. And it is totally another huge burden to imitate Christ because people want to imitate you because you are imitating Christ. So the great beauty of this passage is that it doesn't simply call us to impossibly high standards, but it also throws us back on Christ himself, in whom God has given us everything we need for life and godliness. So yes, it is impossibly high standards, but we have Christ who has given us everything to meet this impossible standard. How was Paul able to meet this impossible standard? So Paul's response to the concern and perhaps even accusation of the Corinthians comes in four broad movements, four broad parts, as he highlights four marks of his life. So all these four are deeply rooted in Christ-like behavior. So let's go to these four marks of Christ-likeness, which Paul is exhibiting, by the way. I don't know if you and me are exhibiting it, but Paul is exhibiting it. Christ-likeness. We are striving to exhibit this. What is the first one? Transparent sincerity. This is explained in chapter 1 of 2 Corinthians, verses 12 to 14. If anybody can read it for me, that will be great. You can just unmute and read. Just these three verses, 12, 13, and 14. Everybody's crawled under a rock already, yeah? come on, let's.
Mark 1, 12 to 14.
Not Mark 1, 2 Corinthians chapter 1.
2 Corinthians, okay.
2 Corinthians
1, 12 to 14. Now this is our boast, our conscience testifies that we have conducted ourselves in the world and especially in our relations with you, with integrity and godly sincerity, we have done so, relying not on worldly wisdom but on God's grace. For we do not write you anything you cannot read or understand, and I hope that as you have understood us in part, you will come to understand fully that you can boast of us just as we will boast of you in the day of the Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Namrata. So, once you read this verse, you could find some little problems with these verses. Solution is also in the verse only. First idea is boasting. For us, for people like us, I don't know for people like us, but for people like me, boasting has an entirely negative connotation. I think you should never boast. Oh, boasting is such a bad thing. You should never boast. Oh, I got a promotion. Oh, I'm the senior manager now. Oh, no. in my mind, I'm thinking boasting is something very bad, very negative. And I'm thinking there's no such thing as good boasting. But for Paul, 8 times out of 10, boasting is a marvelous thing. How can this be? Because Paul is boasting about what Christ has done in us, in him. That is crucial in understanding what Paul is doing here. Because everything he says here is based on the premise that he is what he is by the grace of God. In verse 12, we see that. Not relying on worldly wisdom, but on God's grace. To understand Paul's boasting, and in fact, to understand his transparent sincerity, we need to understand how Paul's identity has been reshaped by his encounter with Christ in the gospel. He's been rebooted by the grace of God. Rebooted. So what will happen if you hit the reboot, restart button on your phone or your computer? All the apps will force shut down and it'll open fresh, right? From the beginning, new open Windows, open Android or iPhone. So basically Paul's old applications started shutting down and one new application opened up. Just one new application, the grace of God. He always logs into this grace of God application, and that application gives him access to boast, gives him the ability to remain transparent, gives him the ability to be sincere, gives him the ability to be Christ-like. Paul's view of himself and the world, his decision-making processes, the way in which he relates to others, his unconditional love, his undeserved kindness that God has held out to him. All of this has come because of this reboot in his encounter with Christ. And that one new application, which is the grace of God. This has changed the whole key signature of his life. Like, what do you say? Key signature of your life. For a human body, the heart is a key signature, because if the heart stops, you stop getting blood and you die. So for a gospel-centered person, the key signature of your life should be within the gospel, should be the grace of God. So this particular event, it has changed the whole key signature of Paul's life. Of course, I'm not saying Paul is perfect, but he's different. He's different from the rest of the people. He's different from the rest of us. He's different from me. So in verse 12, there is a word called behaved, which is an unusual one, which Paul has chosen, because it conveys the idea of pattern of behavior rather than individual action. He's not implying that, Paul is not implying that he takes it. How do I say that? He's not implying that he reached a state of sinless perfection, or that every individual must be utterly free from selfishness or other motives. This is a big picture statement. The big picture. Just take a step back and look at this as a big picture. Saying that his actions have been characterized by transparent sincerity, or using his own words, simplicity and godly sincerity. So there were many people passing through Corinth who may have been making living from what he calls earthly wisdom, from what Paul is calling as earthly wisdom. They were happy to, talk about themselves and fill up their pockets, but not Paul, because he has been recalibrated by the grace of God. He has been rebooted by the grace of God. And that means that with Paul, what you see is what you get. He is transparent, wholeheartedly sincere. And that is really the way it should be. Do you think Paul is hiding anything from the Corinth? Do you think he is downplaying his anger? Do you think he is downplaying his grace? No. Paul is just being a transparent open book. He's being sincere with the church, transparently sincere. In verse 13 and 14, he underlines that he wasn't showing off. He wrote, to help the Corinthians get the truth about Jesus so that on the day of our Lord Jesus, you will boast of us as we will boast of you. Paul keeps banging on this one same thing. Because of Christ, we are in this together. We suffer together for him. We encourage each other together in him. We will be brought home together by him. So now Paul knows that they haven't quite got this yet. But he longs for them to get it and to get to the place where they can boast about, you know, what our Lord Jesus has done in the lives of his glory. He wants them, he wants the Corinth church to get to that particular spot, to get to that particular spot where they can boast. How will they get there? How will they be able to boast? When they become Christ-like. It is Christ who produces in us this straightforwardness, this particular transparent sincerity. Because in verse 12, he says, there's no point in relying on worldly wisdom, but on God's grace. You can't use your own wisdom and thinking to, you know, make yourself transparently sincere. No, you have to rely on God's grace. God will make you transparently sincere. What we can strive to live is, by the grace of God, I am what I am. This is what Paul is also striving. By the grace of God, I am what I am. Not because of my master's degree, I am where I am. Not because of this hard work that I did for the last 20 years, I am where I am. No. Not because of my dad's wealth, I am where I am. No. By the grace of God, I am where I am. Yes, you can work. You can work for your promotion. You can do hard work in your jobs. Yes. But that shouldn't be your centrality. That shouldn't be your sense of security. By the grace of God, I am what I am. So, would people in my family or in my church or in my workplace, will they say that I am straightforwardly open, wholehearted and sincere? Will they say that? Let's ask that question to ourselves. Will anybody say that you are straightforwardly open, wholehearted and sincere? The entire problem with sincerity is that it's almost impossible to fake. For some reason, most of us have this innate, most of us have this ability to sense when somebody is faking or they're acting with a pretense. We know the real deal when we see the real deal. And what is the real deal? Authentic, transparent sincerity that can only be produced by the grace of God in Christ. So when we see somebody faking, you know, trying to be sincere and all, you know, yeah. Humans have this particular sixth sense where they, this person is trying to fake. This guy, this Kevin, simply he only says that he is trying to be sincere. I know behind my back what he does. Oh, I know what he is doing on Friday nights and all. Oh, I know he's not very sincere and honest. That is not how we have to be. That is not how we should be. We should rely on the grace of God. Yes. Yes, God, I am weak. But I am relying on the grace of God. That is where we get authentic, transparent sincerity. That is the first mark, transparent sincerity. What is the second mark? Dependable flexibility. From verse 15 to 22, dependable flexibility. What did I... From the start of this sermon, what was I saying is the trust issue here. Paul is saying that he is going to come and he doesn't show up. That is a trust issue here. So in this particular trust issue, how is there flexibility? So when I'm telling Tarang that, you know, I'm going to come for this movie and I don't come. And again, I tell Tarang, you know, I'm very flexible, you know. I'm just telling you I'll come for the movie, but I'll not come. Now you know how flexible I am. You see how, yeah, I can change plans on the fly. You see how flexible I am. Wait, what? Am I being actually flexible here? Let's see what Paul is saying for this. Because Paul is convinced that, you know, God has Paul is convinced that God has called us to suffer together, to encourage one another, and to boast in what God is doing in each other. He's utterly committed to pursuing this relationship with the Corinthians. That is why he keeps writing. He plans to keep visiting them. More visits. Let's see verse 15 and 16. Because I was confident of this, I wanted to visit you first so that you might benefit twice. I wanted to visit you on my way to Macedonia and to come back to you from Macedonia and then to have you send me on my way to Judea. On the way he's visiting, coming back he's visiting. He's not yet visited, he's planning to visit. It is very striking on seeing Paul's motivation. Is that his travel plans will lead to the encouragement of God's people wherever they are. Paul says a similar thing in Romans chapter 1, verse 9 to 12, where he wants to visit Rome so that he may impart to you some spiritual gift, which is actually grace, to strengthen you, that is, that we may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith, both yours and mine. This is what Paul says in Romans chapter 1, verse 9 to 12. So grace produced a gospel-shaped dependability in Paul. His grip on the message of the gospel itself was firm. You can count on him to spend himself for the good of the church. The problem was that when he didn't show up to the Corinthians church, that the Corinthians became flaky, they became unreliable, they mistrusted Paul, they stopped trusting Paul. But Paul goes on to explain that gospel people need to be dependable and, of course, flexible as well. So, let's say as per the initial plan of me going to a movie with Tarang, now I'm not going for the movie. But what is my reason for being flexible? Oh, sorry, Tarang, I have this Bible study to go to. I can't come for this movie now. Gospel center. Oh, Tarang, sorry, I can't come to the movie with you. I have to meet Paresh. So Paul is putting his priorities in place in order of the gospel, not in order of his personal preference. My personal preference would have been any day to go for a movie. Oh, yeah, 3 hours movie, popcorn, chill, AC. Why will I go and spend time with the church? Why will I go and spend time in Bible study and all with someone? That is boring stuff. What is this? Sitting for 1.5 hours just simply listening to someone. I'd rather watch an action movie. Ooh, Rajinikanth movie I'll watch. Oh, wow. No. Paul is not putting his personal preference in front. He's putting the gospel preference in front of him. How do I know this? Because Paul is explaining in this particular chapter from verse 17 to 19 that his change of plan wasn't because he didn't keep to his commitment, but because circumstances changed. Paul's basic point is that gospel people are dependable because God is completely dependable. That's why Paul makes this very bold statement in verse 20. If you read verse 20, for all the promises of God find their yes in Christ. Because God has shown himself to be utterly dependable in Christ, Paul and his companions can also be completely dependent to put the gospel of Christ first, which will mean when you put the gospel in front, it will mean at times you have to be flexible. You have to reorder your priorities. Why? Why do you need to be flexible and why do you need to reorder your priorities? To serve the gospel good. You need to be flexible and reorder your priorities to serve the gospel good. Paul thought he was serving the gospel good by not visiting the Corinthians. And Paul would agree that this is exactly the kind of thing he's working towards. He is trustworthy. He belongs to a trustworthy God. This is why he would never say yes and no in the same breath. In verse 18, we see that. His priorities are always gospel priorities. When it comes to advancing the gospel, it was never yes and no. In Christ, it will always be yes. Jesus was resolutely dependable in saying, not my will, but yours. Jesus said this, not my will, but yours. Jesus was talking to God, not my will, God, but your will, when he was hanging on the cross. Paul is following in his steps. Paul is following in Jesus' steps. Paul is saying, you know, not my will, God, but your will. Paul wanted to go to the Corinth church. That is why he's saying so many things. You know, I'll come visit you here, come visit you then. While going, I'll come. While coming back, also I'll come visit you. But somewhere, it was not God's will. So then, what are we to do? How are we to respond? How will we know where to commit and where to, you know, be flexible? Verse 20, that is the answer. We are to answer this faithfulness with our own uttering, our amen to God for his glory. Because we can rely on God. This leads us into a gospel reliability. Verses 21 and 22. Now it is God who makes us both, you and me, stand firm in Christ. He anointed us, set his seal of ownership on us, and put his spirit in our hearts as a deposit, guaranteeing where it is to come. It is God who makes us both, you and me. It is God who makes us both stand firm in Christ. So let us ask each of us this question. Are you dependable, flexibly? Can you be counted on to put the gospel first and to arrange your life around the priorities of the gospel? Paul's mission, his decisions, his pattern of life, and therefore his words are not perfect, but they rest on the bedrock of the character of God. So they are in sync with God's gospel, that Paul can speak of the integrity of his words and commitments with utmost confidence. So Paul is not the perfect person. Paul is not a sinless man, but he is different. And this is the shape of the grace of God, which makes available to us the grace of God. Are we gospel-driven people? Let us ask each of us this question. Are we gospel-driven people? Why should gospel-driven people be deeply trustworthy? How can people like us live in a way which is both transparent and sincere? When I mean people like us, when I mean people like me who have so much to hide, how can people like us who have so much to hide live in a way which is very transparent and sincere? I don't want to be transparent. I want to hide all my sins. I don't want to be sincere because I have other priorities. Paul is living an example. He's not just telling, you know, live like Christ. He's telling, imitate me because I live like Christ. A very bold statement to make. Be transparent like me. Be sincere like me. Because I see this is how I'm being transparent. This is how I'm being sincere. So do this. Can I say the same to myself? Can each of us say the same to ourselves? Let's look at the third mark. Robust love. Robust love. Chapter 1, verse 23. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 23 to chapter 2, verse 11. The main result of a gospel-shaped life is that we love people enough to spend ourselves so that we serve them. Of course, God alone can produce real joy. But how does he do that? He does it by the Spirit, through the ministry of the gospel, to which he calls us. Matthew 28. God has called us for the ministry of the gospel. main thing, the only thing God wanted to do, the only thing Christ wanted to do was to further the gospel. And for that, who is God calling? He's calling me. He's calling you. He's calling each and every one of us. What a great privilege that is. So for that, I must put that priority first and my priority second. Furthering the gospel is the first priority. Furthering my career will be second priority. And then furthering my fashion, furthering my wardrobe will be, down the list. But today, if I ask the question to myself, that is in the top of my list. Oh, okay, Sunday. Oh, after church, I'm going shopping. Ooh, 4K, 4,000 rupees to spend on one sherwani. Oh, yes, I'm doing that. Ooh, wedding shopping. What decoration should I buy? What color flower should I buy? Read what Paul is saying first. Imitate Paul's life. Then you can go buy sherwani. Wow. Wow. Paul, man. I don't know how Paul is doing this. Paul is human too. He would have had human needs. He would have wanted new clothes because he's traveling all the time. I'm not even going out of my house because of lockdown, and I want new clothes. This is echoing precisely what Paul says here. In all his ministries, he's urging people to embrace both the seriousness and the satisfaction of the gospel. And his goal is to see people delight in God. That is all. This is what robust love looks like. So do you love people in your church? Do I love Tarang enough? Do I love Paresh enough? Do I love Subhash enough? The people you sit alongside are the people you serve. The people you sit alongside are the people you teach. If you do, then you will be preoccupied with them and you will be weighed down by the responsibility of leading, pushing and prodding them into the joy in Christ. You'll be ready to do anything to help them know that joy that you already have. And you will be willing to refrain from doing anything that would deflect you from the gospel faithfulness, which leads to this particular joy. For this is what Christ-like love looks like. It is love which understands that my joy and yours are organically connected. What love? Christ-like love. Christ-like love makes us understand that my joy and your joy are organically connected. But if it is Kevin's love, what is my joy? Shopping. Oh. What is Tarang's love? Oh, listening to music. Is it connected organically? No. Do I love him? No. Am I serving him? No. Am I teaching him anything? No. But Christ-like love, under that, I have a joy that I have that Christ has given me. I want to share this with Tarang. Now Tarang is also having that joy, Christ-like joy. Now we are organically connected. The same thing should be for the entire church. Everybody should be organically connected. Ooh, that is the church, not this building, not this box. That is not the church. The people, we are the church. We have to be organically connected. We have to bring each other up. We have to love each other. If I don't love Tarang, then who will love Tarang? Oh, I know, obviously Ruth loves Tarang, but I'm looking at the bigger picture here. So this just jumped out of me of what Paul says in chapter 2, verse 1 to 4. He knew, sorry, let me read from 1 to 4. So I made up my mind that I would not make another painful visit to you. For if I grieve you, who is left to make me glad but you whom I have grieved? I wrote as I did, so that when I came, I would not be distressed by those who should have made me rejoice. I had confidence in all of you that you would share my joy. For I wrote to you out of great distress and anguish of heart and with many tears, not to grieve you, but to let you know the depth of my love for you. He knew, so Paul knew that if he had come, he would have caused more pain and they would have been more miserable. How? Why is Paul thinking that way? So Paul is bringing this love, this Christ-like love to these people. And he is seeing them not reciprocating any of that. He is seeing them still in that particular filth. He is still seeing them in sin. And here is Paul bringing all this Christ-like love. And when he sees them, is Paul going to take it very lightly? Oh, I am bringing all this Christ-like love. You are still in your puddle. Okay. Here, I will still give you love. In verse 2, it says, for I grieve in you. Paul is grieving in them. Paul is being sad for them. Paul is being saddened by their actions. Why is he sad? Who among you is left to make me glad? He feels very discomforted of being robbed of the joy of seeing them flourish and of not being able to share his own joy in Christ with them. This is a very painful situation for Paul. That's the spirit in which he wrote, sending the letter out of much affliction and anguish of heart and with many tears, not to cause you pain, but to let you know the abundant love that I have for you. Verse 4. So I'm not married, but married people will know, you know, when you have kids, they are the source of greatest joy and the greatest frustration in someone's life. That's the territory where love operates. That borderline is where love operates. And so this is what it's like to live together for the gospel. You have a very great joy for them, but when they don't reciprocate or when they don't live a Christ-like life or when they don't have a gospel-centeredness in them, you have this very great frustration because you're thinking in your mind that, Lord, I loved him. I gave him everything. I worked with him. I gave him the gospel. I explained everything to him. And he's still not doing that. Same thing with kids. You know, you can teach them to eat with a spoon for 5 months. Sixth month, they'll just throw the spoon out the window, put their hand in, put their nose in. You'll feel very frustrated. You'll feel like giving one whack on that head. That is where love operates. Greatest joy and the greatest frustration comes together. This is the exact feeling what Paul is feeling here. To follow Jesus is to walk in the steps of Jesus. He wept over Jerusalem. He wept at the grave of Lazarus. He had drops of blood for sweat. Why was he dropping drops of blood? Because at the prospect of dying in my place, he went to his death on a cross for me. This is the strong love that God has shown us and the strong love that God has called us to. Will I weep at the grave of my friend? Will I hang on the cross for my friend? Will I sweat drops of blood for my friend? Paul gives further evidence of the warmth of his love for the church in Corinth. From verse 5 to 11, as he turns to a very specific Corinthian issue. Previously, Paul had encouraged them to deal firmly with someone who had sinned spectacularly and publicly. This is from 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1 to 5. That particular sin. So Paul has heard to his encouragement that they did that. But now, tough old Paul, the one who is so insistent on church discipline, tells them that enough is enough. Not because of any personal agenda, but because of the need for the whole church, hurt by this sin, to experience the embrace, the healing that flows from repentance. Now that discipline has been exercised and the person is brought to repentance, Paul tells the church that, you know, forgive him and comfort him so that he may be overwhelmed by excessive sorrow. So that he may not be overwhelmed by excessive sorrow. So let me just explain that in 1 second. There is one person in the Corinthian church who commits a very great sin in front of the public people. And Paul tells the Corinthian church, you know, you have to take this very firmly. You have to punish him and all of that. Because Paul is concerned of church discipline. Oh, nobody in the church should be undisciplined like that. And here is Paul, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, chapter 2, verse 5. He's saying, if anyone has caused grief, he has not so much grieved me as he has grieved all of you to some extent. Not to put it too severely. The punishment inflicted on him by the majority is sufficient. The punishment is enough. It is sufficient. Now, instead, you forgive him and you comfort him so that he will not be swallowed by his sin. I urge you, therefore, to reaffirm your love for him. What is Paul essentially saying here? So for me to love Tarang is, yeah, okay, yeah, I can love Tarang because he's done nothing bad to me. But for someone who has done a very spectacularly, publicly bad thing to me, will I go and love that person? Very difficult, right? Lord, this person has done so much to me. How will I go and love him? How will I even forgive him? That is exactly what Paul is telling the Corinthian church. This one person has committed this great sin against the church. And Paul is telling them, go, okay, now go forgive him. Bring him back to church. Repentance is the best thing. This love that he's showing is nothing. Nothing can just come equal to this love, except God's love for us, except Christ's love that he showed on the cross. Church discipline for Paul has the goal of repentance and restoration. And that is the possibility before the church. In fact, Paul presses on to urge the Corinthians to show that they have really grasped the gospel and are living the light of the gospel, to demonstrate it in grace and forgiveness. His earlier letter demonstrated a test of wholeheartedness. Are you really on board with the gospel agenda? This was Paul's concern. But he had nothing against that particular individual. He's just checking up on the church if they are willing to go for the gospel agenda. This is robust love. This is godly love. This is love which can be trusted. Because he is loving someone who has greatly distressed the church, who has greatly sinned against the church in public. This love, man. Wow, Paul. This love. I don't know how many of us can emulate this love. So in conclusion, remember, Paul writes all this because he desperately wants the Corinthians to stop messing about and start trusting him because they get the fact that his ministry is the real deal and he is the real deal because the gospel he preaches is the real deal. But what are they not getting? It is God through the gospel who produces people and ministry marked by transparent simplicity, number one. Number two, dependable flexibility. Number three, robust love. And number four, real care. So I don't have time to explain much about real care. It's already 12 o'clock. I think most of you are already yawning and sleeping, but let me just conclude here. So as those who want to serve the Church of Christ in the years ahead, our greatest need is to run to Him, follow Him, look to Him. And this hymn that I'm mentioning here, who do you think is that? Is it Paul? No, it's Christ. Yes, you can run to Paul, but Christ is the best example. Paul himself is leading everybody to Christ. Our greatest need is to run to Christ, follow Christ, look to Christ, drink Christ's teaching, so that we will be confident that He will supply our every need. To follow Paul as he follows Christ. All this for what? So that tomorrow, somebody, let's say Tarang only, tomorrow Tarang will follow Kevin, just like Kevin follows Christ. So that Paresh follows Tarang, just like Tarang follows Christ. So that Namrata follows Paresh, just like Paresh follows Christ. But in doing so, we are not merely following a human leader. In the words of 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 21, we are following God who establishes us with Christ, and He has anointed us, and He has put His seal on us and given us His Spirit in our hearts as a guarantee. That is a guarantee that Christ is giving each and every one of us. With that, with those as the parting words, I would like to conclude today's talk. I just like to emphasize on the four important things that I said. Four marks of Christ-likeness. Number one, transparent sincerity, dependable flexibility, robust love, and real care. All this for what? All this for what? To be Christ-like. That's all. That is all Christ is asking you to do. That is all Paul is telling us to do. Very simple, right? No. Yeah, sounds very simple, but right, let's all try this week. Let's try to at least make one mark, one of these marks. Let's try to show real love or real care for someone. Or let's try to be very sincere. Let's try to be dependably flexible for the gospel. Yeah, I'd like to conclude here, and let's end with a small word of prayer. Lord, thank you for giving us this wonderful time, Lord Father. Thank you for giving us your word. Thank you for speaking to us through your word. Thank you for showing us how to be Christ-like. Not once, but twice, through Paul as well. You showed us, and Paul is showing us. And let me show someone else, Lord Father. Let me show someone else how to be like Christ. Yes, it is difficult. Yet, yes, it will be a daunting task, but that is what Christ wants, to be Christ-like. Let us all strive together for that. Let us all remember all this throughout the weeks to come. True love. Transparent sincerity. Dependable flexibility. Let us show all these marks to be Christ-like. Let us show all these marks to our fellow neighbor, to our fellow churchmate, to our fellow colleague. Let them see the true mark of Christ in us. Let them not see the worldly Kevin. Let them not see the worldly Tarang. Let them not see a worldly person in me. Rather, let them see Christ in me, the likeness of Christ in me. Lord Father, give me the strength, give me the courage, and give me the knowledge to do this. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.